most of us only ever get to witness a presidential motorcade from afar or on TV. Presidential limousines, after all, move too quickly. They don't stop for traffic and are always obscured by the security vehicles surrounding them. But here at the National Historical Commission of the Philippines' new Presidential Car Museum in Quezon City, you actually get this close to an actual state car used by presidents from Aguinaldo to Arroyo. The project was many years in the making, with cars sourced from the garages of Malacañang Palace, individual presidential families, and private collections. We first came across some of these cars in 2016, while they were being restored, before they were moved to its new location in Quezon City Circle. When historians study past presidents, they often start by looking at the events and decisions that define their terms in office. But there's also a lot you can tell about a leader and his or her milieu by looking at their choice of official state car. A president's choice will depend on a number of personal requirements and his or her individual taste. But all of these will still need to conform to standards of security, budget, and the availability of models. Though they all tend to be large, long, black, and have the same plate number on them. Number one. The museum collection begins with a car of the very first Philippine president. Who else? Emilio Aguinaldo. Although, just to be clear, when Aguinaldo was proclaimed president, there were no cars in the Philippines yet. This car over here was actually his personal car acquired many, many years after, which is why it doesn't have the plate number one on it. Aguinaldo was chauffeured around in this US-made 1924 Packard way after he was president. But his car set the standard for future state vehicles with a solid divider between the passenger seats and the drivers and top-of-the-line luxuries, including seating for a party of seven. In its day, the V12 Packard was one of America's finest vehicles, and it still looks grand today.
It's interesting. So here he is, the man who fought the Americans in a Revolutionary War ended up acquiring an American vehicle.
Well, we know what happened next. Aguinaldo was forced to make peace with the Americans, ushering in the colonial period, and later, the transition to independence under the Philippine Commonwealth under President Manuel L. Quezon.
The state car of the country's Commonwealth president was a beautiful choice. Well, after all, Manuel Quezon was such an impeccably dressed man after all. The man had taste.
The president, known for his grandiloquent style and speech and dress, knew early on the importance of showmanship in governance. His handsome American-made limousine from Chrysler was an imposing sight, more so in an age when cars were still rare on the road. Called the Airflow, this finely contoured limousine was the most aerodynamic vehicle in its time, an American icon in an industry still dominated by British and German limousines at the time.
This is really interesting. The American-made 1942 Packard of Jose P. Laurel, the Philippine president during the Japanese occupation, was probably not his own choice or his own decision. This was given to him by the Japanese administration of the time, which is really curious because, and ironic actually, because the Japanese were allies of the Germans, and the Germans at that time were producing some of the world's best limousines. Instead, they gave Laurel an American car. Their arch enemies in the Pacific.
Although the Japanese were already an industrial power, cars were not their expertise back then. The American Packard brand, on the other hand, was already established as one of the most luxurious limousines in the world back then. So much so that after liberation, the same unit would be assigned to President Sergio Osmeña Sr. The car was found intact and in pristine condition in Malacañang Palace, one of the few buildings spared by bombs dropped during the Battle of Manila. And with only a few years on it, why not use it? Indeed, acquiring a brand new limousine at a time when the nation was still recovering from war would have been horrible optics.
From Rojas to Marcos, pretty much all Philippine presidents after World War II drove around in American-made limousines, which actually makes sense because the United States was the biggest ally of the Philippines then. But there's another reason. The European manufacturers of limousines were crippled after the war as well. The post-war years and economic boom in the US saw the rise of American marques like Cadillac, redefined the luxury vehicle industry. The 1947 Cadillac Fleetwood series of Manuel Rojas was a popular choice among elite American families, and from here on, a few Philippine presidents as well. His custom-built Cadillac with a body made by bespoke coach builder Fleetwood was fitted out with the most luxurious materials and creature comforts. After years of wartime austerity, luxury was making a comeback. Rojas' successor would be sure of that, even if it meant bringing a Chrysler back to Malacañang Palace. President Elpidio Quirino's Chrysler Imperial Crown was, well, an imperial choice for sure. Imperial was Chrysler's top-of-the-line variant, and the Crown version he owned offered the highest spec available. Quirino's special long-wheelbase version offered seating for eight, which gave it a grand silhouette wherever it passed. However, not all voters would have been thrilled by such displays of luxury. Quirino's rival, Ramon Magsaysay, rode on the populist wave that emerged from growing class inequalities in the 50s. In contrast, Magsaysay was often pictured in an American Willys Jeep, which is also part of the museum collection. Ramon Magsaysay, or My Guy, was known to be the champion of the Philippine masses. And although we often remember him driving around in an American Willys Jeep when he was defense secretary, when he became president, he drove around in this extremely luxurious Cadillac, which is still one of the most collectible versions in the world. Although Magsaysay continued to use Quirino's Imperial Crown, this 1955 Cadillac Series 75 was kept as a reserve vehicle for him and for future Philippine presidents up until Ferdinand Marcos. It's probably among the best-looking Cadillacs ever made. Custom-built to the top-of-the-line Fleetwood Series standards, the Cadillac was extremely comfortable with a seating capacity for eight and a higher-than-usual headroom, thus its nickname, the Cadillac High Headroom Limousine. Taiwanese President Chiang Kai-shek owned a similar one. Magsaysay's untimely death in a plane crash ushered in the presidency of Carlos Garcia. Too bad his is the one missing piece in this otherwise unbroken line of presidential limousines, which continues with the official state car of Diosdado Macapagal. You just gotta love President Macapagal's Cadillac DeVille. Just look at it. The shape, the silhouette is inspired by the space age designs of the time. Groovy is a word you wouldn't use to describe a presidential limousine, but Macapagal's chrome and steel stretch limo was merely reflecting his era's fascination with space travel and science fiction. The Cadillac sedan DeVille, with its elongated shape, sculpted chrome bumpers, and prominent tail fins, had that unmistakable rocket ship look that was all the rage at the time. It was rocket ship fast and powerful too. It remains one of Cadillac's most recognizable cars and a Hollywood favorite featured in various classics. Clearly, cars were entering a new age. Luxury was increasingly defined by technology.
Hard to believe this limousine had keyless entry, which was way ahead of its time. Now, this car looks familiar. You've probably seen it in the many documentaries about President Ferdinand Marcos. That's right. He had this Lincoln Town Car, which was technologically advanced for its time.
Because Marcos's presidency spanned two decades, from the 60s to the 80s, this obviously wasn't the only car he used. Many recall the president riding around in Mercedes-Benz Pullman as well. This Lincoln Continental Mark VI series from the early 80s was one of the state cars he used. Though because TV viewership was more accessible in the 80s, it's probably the reason why we remember this car more than we do others.
The Aquino presidency marked the end of the Marcos era, and also the end of the American limousine era in Malacañang. That's right. From here on, we're starting to see Mercedes-Benzes in the garage of Malacañang Palace.
Was it a deliberate attempt to undo the past, or just keeping up with the times by choosing a Mercedes-Benz S-Class, a brand and model which by the 1980s had become the gold standard of heads of state around the world? Her W126 S-Class long wheelbase version looks rather underwhelming, at least by today's S-Class standards, but it was as rock solid as they came. Curiously, Corazon Aquino's presidential limousines were gifts from the German government after the People Power Revolt and were specially equipped with bulletproofing for added protection. She needed it. Corey endured various coup attempts after all.
So it wasn't just the beginning of the German Mercedes-Benz era in Malacañang. It was also the very first time they started bulletproofing their cars. Which is strange, right? What took them so long?
Corey's anointed successor, Fidel Ramos, used an almost identical model. Talk about continuity between the two, right? Speaking of which, Mercedes-Benz produced the W126 series all the way from 1979 to 1991, the longest production run of the legendary S-Class, or any series so far. Though by the time Erap Estrada assumed office, a new model would already be available for his riding pleasure. The Mercedes-Benz S600 of Estrada was based on the new W140 series, and unlike his predecessor's cars, which needed to be armor-plated by a third party, his new car would benefit from the in-house bulletproofing facilities of Mercedes-Benz under the new Guard division of the brand. Erap's Mercedes-Benz factory-made S-Guard, with bulletproof glass and armor-plated body panels, could withstand small arms fire and certain explosives thrown at it. Though thankfully, Estrada never had to find out for himself until he stepped down as the president and his vice president assumed power with her own version of a Mercedes-Benz S-Guard limousine.
President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo has the distinction of having the longest and the tallest Mercedes-Benz S-Class limousine in Malacañang. That's right, the country's most diminutive president.
GMA's limousine was a stretched S600 Pullman Guard, which was 45 centimeters longer than the standard model. It also had a higher roofline and a taller rear window for additional space and visibility in the rear. An extremely active president who shuttled between the palace, official functions, and the airport often, she was also known to work and hold meetings in the backseat of the presidential car, which this stretch S-Guard was ideal for.
After Arroyo, both Aquino and Duterte opted for a very different kind of vehicle, a Toyota Land Cruiser, starting a trend in presidential SUVs.
Both presidents' cars had yet to be officially turned over to the museum for exhibition. And last we checked, we saw Duterte's Land Cruiser assigned to President Bongbong Marcos. It's not clear if the new president will continue the trend for the more informal style of vehicles set by his two predecessors. But whatever model or make he picks as official state car, it will definitely give us a peek at who he is and what his style of leadership might be.